are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, my name is Dr. Teodros Avery. I am the Associate Professor of Jazz Studies here at CSU Dominguez Hills. And today is the second session of the class called Key Movements, the Age of Jazz. Today I'm going to talk about three very important areas. We're going to talk about the success of the Harlem Hellfighters. We're going to talk about Red Summer. We're going to talk about the New Negro Movement, also known as the Harlem Renaissance. And then we're going to add a fourth area. It's going to be the flappers. We're going to talk about the flappers and the suffragists movement. All right. So firstly, we're going to start with me performing on saxophone over a very popular standard of the time. And the song is called Just Friends. And it is taken from, the song is borrowed from the Tin Pan Alley area of music, of which we've been studying, or we will study. So you get to hear a song that represents that time. Very happy melody, but also sad at the same time. But you'll hear those changes in sound in the song if you can really just kind of listen to the melody of it and listen to how the chords also play. So here we go. This is Just Friends. Mm-hmm. Okay, so now we're going to talk about a great poet by the name of Claude McKay. Claude McKay was born in Jamaica in 1889, and he died in 1948. One of the Harlem Renaissance poets and also a member of Marcus Garvey's organization, the Universal Negro Improvement Association, also known as the UNIA. And now I'm going to read a poem that he wrote called If We Must Die, with hopes that you can get a feeling for what African Americans were living through during the 1920s. You have to understand that there were routine attacks on African Americans, whether it was the fear of getting lynched, or mobbed, or killed by the police. This is just a reality during that time. So his poem is in response to that treatment. So understand that, so you're gonna understand the lyrics. This poem is called If We Must Die. If we must die, let it not be like hogs, hunted and penned in an inglorious spot, while round us bark the mad and hungry dogs, making their mock at our cursed lot. If we must die, oh, let us nobly die, so that our precious blood may not be shed in vain. Then even the monsters we defy shall be constrained to honor us, though dead. O kinsmen, we must meet the common foe. Though far outnumbered, let us show us brave, and for their thousand blows deal one death blow. What thought before us lies the open grave? Like men, we'll face the murderous, cowardly pack, pressed to the wall, dying, but fighting back. So it's important to know this poem and poems like it because it sets the tone, it sets the mood of how Black people were dealing with adversity during the time, and that because there was this new Negro movement, that there was a change in thinking amongst the people, that they were not afraid as they had been in the past. They were fighting. And I can't even say in the past, because there were always situations where people were fighting back. But during this time, they could also fight back intellectually as well as with their fists. So it's important to know, because you want to know that during this time, Black people had a very, very rough time in society and being respected as men, particularly the men, had to endure that type of treatment every day, that they weren't being treated as men. And the women, they had it rough too, because they couldn't speak up or fight as men could, even though they fought back, but they still, the group was dealing with adversity and racial discrimination and all these things as a group. So it's important to know about that. So it's important to really hear that poem and really listen to the words, because it sets the mood for what Black people were going through during that time. And in this class, we're gonna really deal with that, with those changes, with those struggles. And those struggles happen in the music, in the poetry, physically dealing with rights and all kinds of adversity like that. So this poem really gives you a feel for what was going on, and it's important to really tap into that, because this was the norm that Black people were dealing with, that they were dealing with the possibility of almost of having to think about death or, you know, something close to it. So that's a reality. Okay, next we're going to talk about the Harlem Hellfighters. They were a Black regiment that served in France. And you have to understand, at this time, almost 400,000 Black men served in the military during World War I, fighting the Germans, with half of them being stationed in France. So the Harlem Hellfighters were in France, and they freed the French from the possibility of being taken over by the Germans. They were a strong regiment, like I said, out of Harlem, and they fought victoriously in that region and were seen as heroes by the French. And that's very important to know, especially during this time when black people really had to struggle to prove not only their citizenship and their Americanness, but also their manhood. So these men did so during the war, and they did it with complete dominance. I mean, they really pushed those troops back and protected the French. And as a result, they were able to get a lot of respect from France. And that respect has transcended and lasted throughout the years. There's a real love for black culture in France, and it has everything to do with these men going there and not only protecting, but sharing culture with the French. And you should definitely know that there's a somewhat of a symbiotic relationship between France and black American culture. You don't see it from here, but when you go over there and you go to Europe, you can definitely see the influence of black culture on Europe. Now, one of the people that was in the Harlem Hellfighters was a man by the name of James Reese Europe. Now, this man was the leader of the music group of the 369th Regimental Band. So he was the music leader. And he's credited for bringing jazz to Europe because he was the person who was playing jazz when they were in France. And no one had ever brought American jazz over to that region of the world. And the French loved this new music that they were playing. They loved the style of it. They loved how the music sounded. And they loved, the fact that these musicians came over there. They were not only serving in the military, but they brought these instruments, and they were making these instruments sound in a different way than before, you know. And so jazz had its own sound, its own identity that they learned about through these troops and through James Reese Europe. So that's important to know, that James Reese Europe brought jazz to Europe. Okay. Now, one of the sad truths about the Harlem Hellfighters, one of the things that they had to deal with was that they were freeing the French in France, but yet here in America, they did not have freedom. And that was a bitter, bitter, bitter pill to swallow for them, that they were freeing another group, but when they came back to America, they experienced discrimination at its worst. And some of these Harlem Hellfighters lived penniless and homeless when they returned, because there wasn't a lot of support for them through the VA, Veterans Association. And they were seen as heroes, but after the fanfare and the applause wore down, a lot of them didn't have that much to live off of. So that was a very sad reality, that they fought, they freed the French, they came back to America, dealt with discrimination, and then also did not receive financial support. So that's a really sad chapter in the ascent of the Harlem Hellfighters during the war, World War I. Now, we're going to see a video on the Harlem Hellfighters just to kind of give you an idea of what they were like. You see the picture, but you're going to get an idea, feel about their energy and what they meant and how important they were. So let's check out this video on the Harlem Hellfighters. Here we go.
The Harlem Hellfighters was a regiment of New York National Guardsmen in the First World War. They were set up to fail by their own government. They were humiliated, degraded, eventually given to the French army as a throwaway, and they ended up coming home as one of the most decorated units in the entire U.S. Army.
The Harlem Hellfighters are one of the most important regiments in American history. In World War I, they helped to establish to the entire world the power of black soldiers in the military.
It was very difficult at that time for African Americans to get into the United States military because there was this perception that African Americans would not do well in battle. They had to overcome the prejudice of their own countrymen and yet also perform ably on the battlefield.
Like so many units of African American descent, when they go overseas, they're not sure what they're gonna do. Are they gonna fight as infantry? Or are they gonna be stevedores and load ships? Or are they gonna be labor units and cut wood?
And so they're committed to labor duty, they're unloading ships, building the trains, those type of support services. And as you can imagine, these men have been trained and they're willing to fight, they're ready to fight, and this is stressful for them.
They were finally given to the French army, which in a way was an even greater insult because in the First World War, when the United States entered, General Pershing, the commanding officer, was very clear that American forces would not be fed piecemeal into the French and British army because the French and British wanted reinforcements. And Pershing said, absolutely not. When Americans join this war, they will fight as an American force under an American flag led by an American general. ... except for the black guys. You can have them.
Henry Johnson is perhaps one of the most remarkable black military heroes in U.S. history.
And he found himself in no man's land with Private Needham Roberts manning a listening post.
And Needham Roberts hears click, click, click. And he realizes somebody's cutting the wire. It's potentially a German raid.
And so Roberts is passing him grenades and they line up these grenades and the Germans actually do come across the lines. Roberts is hurt and now Henry Johnson is left to defend their position and to stave off this attack. And then he makes the mistake of jamming a French cartridge into his American gun and it no longer will work. And the Germans are on top of it.
He then used his rifle like a club. And then he ended up fighting with a knife against the Kaiser's best and turned them.
He's wounded in the fray. He's struck, for example, in the foot and has a debilitating injury as a result. And he fights them off, he says, for what seemed like an hour.
The Germans ran shrieking into the night, all because of one man.
It's not until the next morning that people realize what a tremendous act this was. They discover four bodies of dead German soldiers, and they also realize from the equipment and other things that are left behind that as many as 30 may have been involved in this altercation.
As soon as he drove off those Germans, the French awarded him with the Croix de Guerre, a great honor. Unfortunately, it took about 75 years for the U.S. government to give him the Legion of Merit. Had he been white, he would have walked out of that war with the Medal of Honor. What was so shocking to me when I began to research the story of the Hellfighters was that after they had performed so magnificently in combat, the United States government actually sent a memorandum to the French government, essentially implementing Jim Crow, essentially saying, don't give them some notion that they are equals because we don't want them taking that notion back to the United States and demanding equality.
When he comes back to the United States, he's not awarded the Purple Heart. There's no notation in his military record of his injury. And so he winds up not being able to work because of this injury. He doesn't get any kind of assistance from the army or from the government as a result. And he ends up dying in 1929 penniless. So it again shows the paradox. Here's this great story of valor and of courage on the part of the soldier, and ultimately he comes back to a nation that doesn't honor that sacrifice.
We tend to think we all know American history so well, but the story of the Harlem Hellfighters should be one of the first stories told. It wasn't about killing other people, it was about being Americans and serving their country well. That was the inclination of the Harlem Hellfighters.
When you are African-American in 1917, democracy is armor. Democracy is a weapon. And to fight for a war to make the world safe for democracy was something more than just some ethereal crusade for the Hellfighters. It had concrete results. They were fighting for the rights to be a citizen of the country that they were born in.
Those are the Harlem Hellfighters, tough soldiers who served for America. Now we're going to talk about what Red Summer is. Red Summer. Black Americans experienced violence during confrontations with whites beginning in East St. Louis, Illinois, in 1917 and ending in 1921 in Tulsa, Oklahoma, with the destruction of Black Wall Street. And we'll talk about that a little later. In Chicago, whites were becoming increasingly fearful of Black migrant workers who were invited up north by factories to fill factory jobs, which were short-staffed because the manpower needed to fight during World War I. Also, Black Americans, such as those who built Black Wall Street, were building their own economic systems to sustain themselves and their communities during segregation. Remember that they, Blacks, were not allowed the same rights as white Americans. This is very important. You have to know what was going on during this time. Red Summer happened in many different parts of the United States because there was a force that didn't want Black Americans to prosper economically in the United States. And violence was the weapon,
whether they used guns, lynching, you know, committed lynchings or anything like that.
Now, Black Wall Street, I want to explain that to you. So in Tulsa, Oklahoma, you had a large Black community that was really self-sufficient. I mean, they had their own theaters, like a whole system, a whole economic system that they had right there. Theaters, churches, of course, all kinds of businesses, cleaners, everything that's in the town, they had it within their own community. They're prospering very well. But the community right next to them, the Caucasian community, saw that as a threat. And a lot of violence ensued between both groups. People were killed on both sides. And the community was burnt down to the ground. And so this is the kind of reality that they had to face. As they were pulling themselves out of, you know, Jim Crow and the post-slavery conditions, and these were people who were picking themselves up by the bootstraps only to be faced with genocide. So you have to know that. You have to know that they were moving in, you know, in the right direction to be independent Americans, but that they were challenged to not be able to do so. All right? Now we're going to play a video about Black Wall Street in Tulsa, Oklahoma. You're going to gather a strong identity about what I was talking about how self-sufficient this group was and how they had their own community and how their dollars went through the community, I believe as many as 15 times before it left the community. Usually, if you can get your dollar to stay, or if these communities can have their dollar stay in their community for seven times, then they're doing well. It was 15 back during Black Wall Street. So let's watch this video on Black Wall Street. All right.
Some African-American communities are prospering, like the residents of Greenwood, a suburb of Tulsa, Oklahoma. Here, former slaves were given land after the Civil War, and this rare footage shows the thriving town they built. A remarkable Baptist pastor named Solomon Sir Jones is the pioneering filmmaker. His footage was lost for more than 50 years. Jones captures the bustling life of Greenwood, which could be any American small town. Tulsa's whites don't like what they see. In May 1921, after a Black man is accused of assaulting a white woman, a white mob rampages through the city. For a night and a day, they loot and burn Greenwood. A Fox News crew captures the only surviving footage. It is the bloodiest racial massacre in American history, leaving nearly 300 dead.
Wow. Definitely a sad chapter in American history right there. Very sad indeed. Considering that this was a time where black people were expected to, you know, do good for themselves, you know, being that it was only, you know, a few years after slavery, and yet after they did do well for themselves, that they were met with opposition. So definitely a sad moment for that community.
Now we're going to move on. We're going to move on and talk about the foundation of the civil rights movement. So we know that whenever we talk about the civil rights movement, we're usually talking about the 1950s and the 60s, right? With Martin Luther King, Rosa Parks, and all those great people, freedom fighters. But the 1920s New Negro Movement was the precursor to what we saw happen in the 1950s and the 1960s. They really laid the foundation for which the latter civil rights era was able to take many strides and pursue different rights for Black Americans. Now,
the New Negro was a term coined by educator and writer Alan Locke.
There you see Alan Locke right there. He also taught English and philosophy at Howard University. He was educated at Oxford University, also the University of Berlin, and Harvard University.
He was also the mentor to the writer Zora Neale Hurston, who I mentioned in the first session. The New Negro Movement was about Black Americans standing up for themselves instead of being the recipients of some of the worst domestic violence ever committed in the United States. So this is a deviation. We're going away
from the old ways and we're going towards something new, a new way of thinking, a new way of conducting themselves, a new way of practicing economics for their communities. And they really wanted to set a trend for the world, really, to see how they were conducting themselves as Black Americans.
Now, the New Negro Movement was started in 1916 in Harlem, New York. It was built on an independent way of thinking. These were people who pooled their resources together to create their own publications and so they could get their message out. So that was very important for them to have their own newspapers to be able to speak about different problems that existed in their communities.
And also to get the word out about different ideas that they had that they could disseminate to their community through their own newspapers.
Now, they were concerned about issues of the day. One of the issues that they were concerned about was lynching. You can show the picture of lynching, and that is hanging people from trees, right? Now, they were concerned about that because it was a pastime. Now, interestingly enough, lynching was not a Black thing. It was just a thing that people did down South, but it became popular later it became synonymous with Black people.
Because of the struggles of dealing with that.
So lynching was a problem. Lynching was a problem that they were dealing with and they did not want to deal with in the New Negro Movement. So they were writing about it, they were talking about it, and they were actually actively pursuing legislation against it through the NAACP. Okay, now segregation was another problem that they dealt with, segregation. Because with segregation
you have the legal right to not give a group of people what another group of people are getting. So that was another concern of civil rights activists of the 1920s.
Disenfranchisement was another area that they were concerned about.
And this is something that
was really, really important for them to eradicate.
Economic oppression,
you know, the lack of jobs or low pay, you know, pay so low you can't get a decent place to live, or you can't, you know, you can't get a decent place to live. You also can't buy enough groceries for your family to eat, your kids, et cetera. That was very, very important to them to fix. They wanted to fix that.
And then discrimination in the criminal justice system. They were really, really concerned with,
black people doing harder time for the same crime. This is a very important area. These five different areas, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. No, 1, 2, 3, 4. These were different areas that were very important. Five areas that were important for civil rights activists to fix. They wanted to get this out of there. It was keeping black people back.
And interestingly enough, these were the same problems that existed in the 1950s and the 1960s with Rosa Parks, Martin Luther King, all these people fighting the same problems that existed.
So it's important to know that the New Negro Movement was the foundation of the Civil Rights Movement of the 1950s and 60s.
Definitely write that down. Now we're gonna talk about another person by the name of Marcus Garvey. Marcus Garvey. Marcus Garvey was born on August 17, 1887 in St. Anne's Bay, Jamaica. He was a leader in the Black Nationalist and Pan-Africanism movements. He founded the UNIA, or the United Negro Improvement Association. He was self-educated, learning to read while studying
in his father's library.
Marcus Garvey's Universal Negro Improvement Association, the UNIA, was a strong force instilling pride among black Americans. Prior to this movement, blacks didn't see positive images of themselves in most areas of society. And in fact, stereotypical images such as those seen in D.W. Griffith's Birth of a Nation reinforced racial stereotypes. So the UNIA and the New Negro Movement were really saying, hey, we are men. We want to be respected as men. We are not the stereotypes that we're seeing in these movies. We're really moving away from that. So it's important to know that they were going against the grain of what most people in society, how most people in society viewed them. So you want to know that. Now here are some of the businesses that Marcus Garvey, you and I, provided to blacks during this time. You have to understand that the UNIA had a high number of black people who were members of the organization. And so what he did was he provided jobs to different people who were members. He provided as many as 700 jobs. He had the Liberty Hall, which was like a big hall, banquet hall, where they could have different functions, not only for the UNIA, but people could rent it out. He had the Black Star Liner, which was a shipping business that could ship products around the globe. He had several restaurants, which existed in Harlem and also at the Liberty Hall. He had grocery stores, he had laundromats, and a printing company, all under the UNIA. So it really was a cultural and community movement
to really advance black people. So you want to know that.
Now we're going to move on to the NAACP and its founders. The NAACP was founded in 1909 in direct response to the high amount of lynchings which took the lives of black American men. It was founded by two whites and one black man, Moorfield Story, Mary White Ovington, and W.E.B. Du Bois. W.E.B. Du Bois, the editor of the NAACP's publication, W.E.B. Du Bois was the editor of the NAACP's publication. He was a scholar and activist born on February 23rd, 1868 in Great Barrington, Massachusetts. I've actually been to his the area where he was born, the house, the lot, and yeah, I went there about maybe 7, 8 years ago. In 1885, he became the first African-American to earn a PhD from Harvard University. For most of his life, he lived as a biracial man. That is until he went down south to attend Fisk University in Nashville, Tennessee. It was there that he began to analyze and challenge the Jim Crow laws, which were the pillars of racism during the 1920s. The foundation that he helped to create, the NAACP, still exists today, as the NAACP is still active in the fight for equal rights. Now, when he was up north, he wasn't faced with the realities of being racially mixed. But when he went down south, like I said, that's when he felt it, that he was actually black, that he was different. It was through those experiences that he decided to dedicate his life to eradicating racism. So he went down there and he actually felt it, saw it. And he was from Massachusetts, and apparently he didn't experience those negative responses to his presence and to others as well. So the NAACP's paper was called The Crisis. The Crisis was also a strong force in pushing the rights of black Americans and of Africans abroad. This became the first step as many African countries began to pursue independence from colonial rule after World War II. So W.E.B. Du Bois would write in The Crisis and write about different problems that he saw, different causes.
And he had different ideologies that he would enforce through the paper. So he was a great and prolific writer as well as an activist. You know, a lot of these people could write, and they would use the pen as a way to really push their agenda.
Next, we're going to move on to Susan B. Anthony and Elizabeth Cady Stanton. Here they are right here. There were two women who, they were the two women who were the pillars of the struggle for women's rights. They really did a lot of work in pursuing equality for women. And they did it out of experiences that they experienced when they experienced discrimination.
Because they were women.
Susan B. Anthony was born on February 15, 1820 in Adams, Massachusetts. She grew up in a Quaker family, developing strong moral character at a young age. And then we have Elizabeth Cady Stanton. She was born on November 12, 1815
in Johnstown, New York.
Her father was a Federalist attorney who served one term in the U.S. Congress and also became a circuit court judge and a New York Supreme Court justice. Her father was highly influential on her becoming politically active. Susan B. Anthony met Elizabeth Cady Stanton in 1851. And together they fought against slavery and discrimination against women while achieving the right of women to vote in America. And it's very, very interesting that although they were women and they were Caucasian women, I want you to really check this out, that they were fighting against slavery as well. So they were concerned about human causes. It wasn't just for women. They were concerned about unjust causes for everybody, right? So that's important to note as well, because I find that to be extremely impressive, that they weren't only concerned about themselves. They were like, hey, let's fix a lot of things that are going wrong. Now we're gonna watch a video about the suffragist movement, or the right to vote, the fight to vote. And we're going to watch that right now. Here we go.
This is the story of our mothers and grandmothers who fought to vote only 90 years ago. The fact is, it wasn't until 1920 that women gained the right to go to the polls and vote after a difficult and hard-fought battle. wanted their voices to be heard, and on November 15, 1917, a brave group of innocent and defenseless women picketed the White House carrying signs asking for the vote. But by the end of the night, they were arrested and jailed, and eventually transferred to an abandoned workhouse located in Virginia, where many would barely survive. What unfolded is called the Night of Terror, when the warden at the workhouse ordered his guards to teach a lesson to the suffragists imprisoned there, because they dared to picket Woodrow Wilson's White House for the right to vote. Prison guards wielding clubs and their warden's blessing went on a rampage against the 33 women charged with obstructing sidewalk traffic. They beat Lucy Burns. They chained her hands to the cell bars above her head and left her hanging for the night, bleeding and gasping for air. They hurled Dora Lewis into a dark cell, smashed her head against an iron bed, and knocked her out cold. Her cellmate, Alice Kossu, thought Lewis was dead from a heart attack. For many weeks, the women's only water came from an open pail. Their food, all of it colorless slop, was infested with worms. Additional affidavits describe the guards grabbing, dragging, beating, choking, slamming, pinching, twisting and kicking the women. When one of the leaders, Alice Paul, embarked on a hunger strike, they tied her to a chair, forced a tube down her throat, and poured liquid into her until she vomited. She was tortured like this for weeks until word was smuggled out to the press. Woodrow Wilson and his cronies tried to persuade a psychiatrist to declare Alice Paul insane so she could be permanently institutionalized. The doctor refused. Alice Paul was strong, he said, and brave. That didn't make her crazy. The doctor admonished the men. Courage in women is often mistaken for insanity, he said. This is a real depiction of the battle these women waged so that other women can pull the curtain at the polling booth and have their say. What would those women think of the female voting record now? If you think that voting is more of a burden than a privilege, if you think it's too much trouble and you don't have time, if you think that someone else should make your choices for you, maybe you should look these women in the eyes and tell them why.
Wow, pretty powerful, man. They went through a lot of pain. You definitely have to give those women their props. I'm thinking about my mother and when she would go vote and, you know, realizing that these women really put in some work. Man, it's rough. The torturing, that's horrible. But it's part of our country's history, and you can learn a lot about today by studying the past. So don't be discouraged by these troubling things that you see and hear here in this class. It's all about learning here. But they were real troopers, and they really sacrificed a lot. Wow.
Okay, so women had gained the right to vote in 1920 with the passage of the 19th Amendment to the U.S. Constitution. This amendment ushered in a new type of woman. A new young woman, full of life, full of freedom, and they wanted to feel that freedom that these other women had worked hard for them to achieve. And these women were known as flappers. There we go. So you've seen this image before. This is the,
You know, not to be confused, they are not feminists in terms of like what Susan B. Anthony was, but they were feminists in terms of like, they weren't political feminists, but they were in terms of the life that they wanted to live. They wanted to be free from men's oppressive ways. They wanted to dress how they wanted to. They were influenced by French fashion. They loved to wear, you know, the furs and the skirts, and they loved to dance. And during this time, they really pushed back against society's expectations of them because society really frowned upon them for having this freedom, you know, showing their arms. As you see the woman right there, her bare arms, her neck. You know, that was not the way that people expected young women to carry themselves. They expected them to be covered up and they wanted them to be quiet. These women were living it up. In New York City and other places. They really, really were living their lives to the fullest and enjoying themselves. You know, they had the bob haircut, they wore makeup, they went to what they called petting parties. They were just really doing their thing. So in the words of Arthur Untermeyer, he said, flappers are flaming youth personified. So they were the youthful young women living it up, doing what they wanted to do, speaking loud and clear. And with that in mind, I'm going to read this poem. It's called Flappers Are We. Okay, here we go. Flappers are we, flappers are we. Flappers and fly and free. Never too slow, all on the go. Petting parties with smarties. Dizzy with dangerous glee, Puritans knock us because the way we're clad. Preachers all mock us because we're not bad. Most flippant young flappers are we. So they're telling everyone who expects them to behave, we don't need it, we're doing our own thing, whatever, buzz off. So that was a different attitude directly coming out of the suffragist movement and the strides that those women were making for women in general. And they, but over on the social side of things, they were living it out and really enjoying the foundation that Susan B. Anthony and Elizabeth Stanton really fought for. So you want to know that it was a foundation, and then there was a younger generation that reaped the benefits of all the hard work that was put in. And it happens in different cultures. It happens where you have the older generation that's fed up, and then the newer generation is able to benefit from those strides. Now, the flappers, they were the real women that we saw in the photos and everything. They influenced a cartoon character that you may have seen. See her less today than you did, say, in the 80s, but her name is Betty Boop. Betty Boop. So Betty Boop was a cartoon character. You can see she has the same kind of bob haircut. She's showing her legs and her arms. And she is, you can tell by the look in her eyes, she's more into her own thing. She's not so much caring about what other people think. She's kind of looking up like whatever, you know. So she was a character that really showcased what a flapper was, but in cartoons. And so we'll talk about her more later, but that just gives you a cartoon version of who the flappers were. So that's important to know.
Okay, well, at this point, we're going to sum it up. Before I do so, I would like to let you all know that we would like for you to visit our website for CSU Dominguez Hills for the music program. If you are in the area and you'd like to study music, we would really like for you to apply to the music program. You're going to see the URL on the screen in a second, csudh.com. Edu. Okay, there it is right there. Can you put that URL up too? And so the URL, you type that in, it'll bring you right to the website and you can go through it, find out about our music programs. The director's name is Dr. Scott Morris. And he's doing great things here at Dominguez Hills. And if you're interested in studying music, reach out to us, because we would like for you to come here and to study music. csu.edu/music, M-U-S-I-C. You see the website there. And then also, if you'd like to get to know who I am through my music, you can visit my website, which is www.teodrosavery.com.
And you're going to see the URL in a second, www.teodrosavery.com. There it is right there. And you see me playing saxophone on the rooftop in downtown LA. That's me. So you can visit my website as well and find out about what I'm doing, any concerts, my bio, any albums, anything like that.
All right, so that concludes the session 2, and we'll be back for the next session shortly. So make sure, I want to tell all the folks who are taking the class, take notes. Make sure that you really write down or type up the ideas that I mentioned that I'm accentuating and making important, because you will need to know that information later when you take your test.
And so I'm letting you know now that that's the way that you'll be able to do well on your test, is if you take good notes and really go through the video properly, okay? So you'll be cool if you do that. All right, thank you so much, and we'll see you on the next one.
All right, peace.